Okay, there's a huge list of names here. There are lots of people involved in various bits and pieces associated with this talk. It goes all over the place, so beware. Just a bit of background on bottom pressure recorders and where they fit into our observing system. So we have altimetry and tide gauges obviously measure the sea surface. The Argo system is measuring density in the interior. And grace and bottom pressure recorders are our way of measuring the pressure at the bottom of the ocean. I always like to point out this though. As you go shallower and shallower, Argo becomes less relevant in this equation. Bottom pressure and sea level become the same thing. And in fact, many tide gauges are actually bottom pressure recorders. So if you want to think about extrapolating what's going on at the edges into the interior, there are two ways of doing it. You can follow the surface or you can follow the bottom. The bottom pressure or the sea level both have tide gauge measurements as their edge version. This is the sort of thing we're talking about. This is a typical bottom pressure recorder, one that we've been deploying in the south of Drake Passage. We actually have a time series of over 20 years now of measurements down in the south of Drake Passage. They're quite small things, just a capsule and buoyancy and batteries. Nothing very dramatic. And they're growing in number. This is from a recent paper of Richard Ray's on tidal analysis based on bottom pressure records. And you can see there is now actually quite a large number of dots on the map. That's quite new. 10 years ago, there would have been far fewer. Lots of different experiments these are associated with. Probably getting on for half of these are from the DART array associated with tsunami monitoring. Some of them are to do with tides, measuring, getting long records for tides, but some of them are to do with different parts of ocean circulation. And the record lengths associated with these dots, most of them are longer than a year. There are a few a little bit shorter, and Richard included some much shorter ones because he was focusing on tides and wanted the spatial distribution. But most of these on the map are now quite long records. So why measure bottom pressure? Well, this is a very silly plot. What I've done is taken, this is from one particular ocean model. It's a high resolution simulation of 12th of a degree. And there are 17 years of data, of 5 day averages of sea level, inverse barometer corrected sea level actually. And it's just the standard deviation plotted on a scale that saturates at 5 centimetres. So huge swathes of the ocean are beyond that limit, they're saturated. There's just a few regions towards the east and towards the tropics where it gets quiet, and some shelf regions where the 5 day averaging has done quite a lot of, had quite a large effect, because of course there are quite large signals on shorter timescales. That's what you see if you look at sea level. If you look at the bottom, the vast majority of what this is eddies. And that's what you see in satellite altimetry. You can see all of this stuff, small scale, wiggly stuff, which from the point of view of sampling the ocean is a real nuisance. If you want to measure what's going on the large scales doing integrals, you don't want to have a system that has this kind of thing going on in it. So that's the surface. That's what happens at the bottom. And you'll notice the scale has changed. We've got a 2 centimetre saturation point now. And now more than half of the ocean is not saturated. And in fact, even this region along the continental slope is not saturated. We have signals of order a centimetre variability. In other words, it's much quieter in bottom pressure. And not only much quieter, but much larger length scales typically. So if I take an average of bottom pressure all the way along this continental slope, take that one time series and then subtract that off from every single point, then the the signal drops all the way along the slope. So most of what you're seeing along that slope is coherent along the whole slope. We're down to 0.4, 0.3 centimetres. So it's 3 millimetres variability now. And we actually have measurements along these three sections. This is associated with the RAPID project to measure the meridional overturning circulation in the North Atlantic, which Rory's talk will go into in more detail, the relationship between sea level and the MOC. But here we have a set of bottom pressure recorders. You see the time series associated with them. And just looking at it, you can see how well correlated they are. So this mode is all the way down the slope. Correlations between 0.61 and 0.96 among all of these. And in fact, some of them are quite deep. Some of them are penetrating into that eddying region. So you wouldn't expect such great correlations. Looking in a bit more detail in the model, we've extracted this patch of data, patch of bottom pressure, and reorganized it as a function of depth and distance along the continental slope. So you can think of yourself as sort of standing in the middle and looking at the western boundary. And first of all, we just look at the depth average at each position along the slope and correlate that with the average along the whole slope. So this is the correlation coefficient. These buttons are fiddly. This correlation coefficient above 0.8 for that depth average. So again, it's all very well correlated, all going up and down together. And then we have the first EOF. So after subtracting out the depth average, we're looking at the bit of the pressure that's varying as a function of depth. And the first EOF captures sort of 60% of the variance at all distances. This is a separate EOF at each distance along the slope, so they're completely independent of one another. And again, we can compare that with the observations. The first EOF from the observations has this sort of linear function of depth after you've subtracted out a reference, actually, which we take as the shallowest version. You see how the pressure is changing almost linearly with depth for different deployments, as it does at each position along the slope. So these are all the whole set of independent EOFs at each position along, all showing the same kind of structure. And when we do a regression to find where the node is, where the zero is, it's there in the observations and it's the same place in the model. So we really are getting a meaningful picture of what's going on along the slope there. But again, the interesting part is the coherence. So this is now that first EOF. So we're not looking at the mode where everything's going up and down together. Now we're looking at the pressure being high at the top of the slope, low at the bottom, or vice versa. And this is the mode associated with changing overturning circulation. And you see, again, as a function of time and distance along the slope, these signals are, at least in the model, very coherent over this large range of latitude. A completely different picture to what you would get if you did the same thing just a little bit offshore, because then you'd be totally dominated by the eddies, which do reach down to the bottom there. So that was one example. Here's another region which also has a huge number of eddies. In fact, the Southern Ocean is probably the most energetic region of the world generally, completely dominated by eddy variability. Starts to get a bit quieter as you go south here, you can see, but of course the ice gets in the way. But amidst all that nasty, messy stuff, again, this is a model simulation. We're looking at now 50 years of 5-day averages. And this is just a straight correlation coefficient between the bottom pressure at any one group point and the total flow through Drake Passage. So if you want to monitor the strength of the circumpolar current, that's the obvious place to monitor, the constriction where you know exactly where northern and southern boundaries are. Integrate the flow through there, you get a time series which is varying, and it correlates with the bottom pressure all the way along the boundary of Antarctica. And in fact, this is the 1 in 3 kilometre contours, depth contours, so that line of very high correlation is exactly on the continental slope, the very steep region around Antarctica. So we've got bottom pressure measuring the meridional overturning circulation, we've got bottom pressure measuring the strength of the circumpolar current, and again, observations from tide gauges all around Antarctica, and this is bottom pressure at these two points, the Drake South and the Myrtle, here and here. You can see they're pretty well correlated. It's all going up and down together. It's less well correlated at the edge than along that mid-depth region, but still pretty well correlated. So, again, going to the right place, looking at regions where the eddies aren't dominating, and that's at the bottom of the continental slope, is really giving you a nice picture. When we look at longer timescales, it gets even more dramatic, because the spectrum of bottom pressure is quite different from sea level. It's a much flatter spectrum, less red. And so if we look at the standard deviation of the running annual average of bottom pressure, so again, this is from the Occam 12 degree model, you see there are big swathes of the ocean where practically nothing is happening. This is less than 2 millimetres of interannual variability. That's quite a contrast to the sea level at any one point. So this is a couple of particular points in the Pacific that were chosen to have the same standard deviation, but that's for other reasons. And you see the kind of variability you have at any one point compared with, this is the global average from altimetry from the Albizo data set. And if I just stick on a 3 millimetre per year trend, you can see how clearly that is a 3 millimetre per year trend and how unclearly that might be. Huge amounts of variability compared to the trend, but in the global mean you have small variability compared to the trend, which makes it sensible to try and fit a trend. So when we go to the bottom, this is three different ocean models, and it's at this particular point, site S we call it. These are time series of bottom pressure and of an annual running mean through there. And if I plot that 3 millimetres per year on there, you can see it would be very easy to detect trends of that kind of size in bottom pressure at just one point. So, they're brilliant, they're fantastic, they can do absolutely everything. They filter out eddies, you can measure large-scale transports, the circumpolar transport, the meridional overturning circulation, and measure total ocean mass changes, or barostatic sea level, as we now call it. Rather small at the bottom, but in capital letters and red. But, and as anyone who knows anything about bottom pressure recorders, there is a big but. Looking to do that, weighing the ocean's job. If you go to these very quiet places, you can select a collection of bottom pressure recorders. These are all actually part of the DART array for tsunami monitoring. And if you look at what they actually look like, once you've taken out the short period tides, that's what you actually measure. All the results I've shown you so far have been after we've taken out this kind of trend. But they all have this big drift. Not a linear drift either, it has an exponential tail and then a linear end part. And just to give you an idea of scale, these are 15 centimetres between records, and they're clearly much more than that in the drifts. If you want to see more about this, Joanne Williams has a poster downstairs which goes into more detail. I'll skip through some of the details here. Basically, from all of those data sets, we take a model to an ocean model to remove the ocean dynamics, an analysis for atmospheric pressure. We take out long period tides and the pole tide, just from first principles, and we fit the trend, but we have to fit the trend at the same time in an iterative method with the with an annual cycle in order to make sure that we don't remove the annual cycle at the same time. Take all of that out, what should be left is just ocean mass changes. Plus something to do with the change in the Earth's gravity field and the loading and self-attraction effects. So it's total mass, but it's only due to mass, but it's not uniform around the entire ocean. And this is what happens, what you get once you've subtracted all of those things out. So you see the coloured lines are the individual records, the purple line is one annual cycle fitted through all of them. You can see they have slightly different amplitudes and phases because of this loading and self-attraction effect, but it's one annual cycle fitted to all of them. It does a fantastic job, except in some places where it doesn't, where clearly the ocean model is not capturing all the dynamics. But there are most of these supposedly quiet places really are quiet and are turning out to give us a measure of the annual cycle of the ocean's mass. This is the PDF that we get. We can actually quantify the area very nicely now. And it's a peak just after October, an amplitude of a bit less than a millibar, 0.86, I think, is our current best estimate. And if we blow that up and also fold in some uncertainty from the model, the ocean model part, by using multiple models here, we get this bullseye of, we believe that's where the annual cycle is. And these dots, stars and triangles and things, these are different people's determination of the same thing from GRACE, ARGO, altimetry, lots of different methods. So we're getting the same kind of level of accuracy, at least, as those determinations. So bottom pressure recorders are brilliant at timescales of about a year or less, and horrible at longer timescales, which is a real shame, because if they could work at much longer timescales, they would give us enormous amounts of information. We can make some progress by overlapping deployments, so that we have a 2-year deployment and another 2-year deployment with a 1-year overlap. That helps to get rid of some of the exponential part. Does absolutely nothing for your linear drift, of course, because you don't know either of the linear drifts. And it doesn't perfectly remove the nonlinear trend either. We could invent a new kind of instrument. That would be great, and I really don't see why we shouldn't be able to do that. This is 40-year-old technology that we're talking about. It's got a lot better over the years, but it's still the same technology that we were using 40 years ago. Bright ideas, I'm sure, are out there somewhere for someone to invent a new kind of instrument that doesn't have this drift problem. And I'm trying to find them myself, but if anyone else has a great idea, this is a really big problem. It's a problem that has lots of applications if it can be solved. Please, write ideas, anyone. The other way of getting around it is not to actually use a bottom pressure recorder in the first place, but do indirect bottom pressure measurement. So analogous to altimetry plus ARGO gives GRACE, we can do point measurement, sea level from maybe GPS plus a long mooring gives implied bottom pressure. And I just want to give one example of something that we've been doing along those lines, where actually we haven't been doing the vertical, we've been doing it down a slope, so at an angle. So we don't just need the density to do this difference between pressures down the slope. You need the currents as well. Which makes this a harder problem, but it does seem to work well. So here's a section of the continental slope off Halifax, Nova Scotia. We have six bottom pressure recorders going down the slope, but also density and current measurements at the same place. These are the six bottom pressure records. You can see how hugely coherent they are. But then when you take the difference between 2 and 1, 3 and 1, 4 and 1, you get these time series. And if you look carefully, you can see that there are actually two curves on each of these. One, the grey curve, is the directly measured difference from the bottom pressure recorders. The black is inferred from density plus current measurements down the slope. And actually, we can go from 1,000 metres to 3,500 metres and get an error of half a centimetre, half a millibar, in this reconstruction. It gets messier at the bottom because we actually have some missing measurements down there, so we can't get this RS6 one quite so neatly. It's still not too bad, but not quite so well. Why would we bother to do this? It seems very difficult when we have GRACE. Well, GRACE is brilliant. I don't want to say anything against GRACE. I wouldn't want people to stop flying GRACE type machines, certainly. But it's not perfect. It does need extra information to tell you about the geocentre and probably degree 2 terms as well, the very largest scale patterns. Also, the smallest patterns are missing. It has very coarse spatial resolution. And from the point of view of monitoring many of these ocean things, you really want to target those continental slopes of very narrow regions when you're looking down. GRACE can't resolve that, and I doubt any satellite will be able to resolve that. But also, as Gary pointed out on the tide gauges, we want an independent check of what we're measuring. And we also want to be able to bridge gaps between gravity machines. We want a separate system. So, following on from the question to Annie yesterday about what would be an important new observing system, this is my candidate. I think we could do some fantastic stuff with a bottom pressure recorder, ideally, a magic new bottom pressure recorder that doesn't have drift, a tall mooring measuring density, and a GPS buoy on the top. And that's for the Argo GRACE, altimeter Argo GRACE system. This is the equivalent of a tide gauge for just the altimetry system. Just a few of these in the right places targeted would be a magnificent addition to our global observing system. So I'll finish there, thanks.